From New York, this is Democracy Now!
Biden has inherited the strategy of Donald Trump and is now engaging in retaliatory tit-for-tat military strikes at a time when the diplomatic track with Iran and a potential return to the nuclear deal is looking as bleak as ever.
A U.S. military base near a Syrian oil field came under attack Monday, one day after U.S. airstrikes bombed an Iranian-backed militia in Syria and Iraq. We'll get the latest. Then, no climate, no deal. Dozens of youth climate activists are arrested at the White House demanding Biden back an infrastructure bill that includes major investments to confront the climate emergency. We'll speak to New York Congressmember Jamal Bowman.
Congressman Bowman here representing New York 16, right outside the One House, hanging out with Sunrise, putting pressure on the Biden administration to go big and bold and visionary for our country and for our future and for our planet.
Plus, we go to El Paso, Texas, to speak with leading immigrant rights defender Fernando Garcia about Vice President Kamala Harris's trip to the border.
This border is gonna define the character of the nation. So that this is the new Ellis Island, that we need to build a border that is more welcoming, a border that upholds American values.
All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. The Pacific Northwest is sweltering under an unprecedented June heat wave fueled by the climate crisis, with all-time high temperatures shattered in Oregon, Washington, and British Columbia for the second day in a row. Seattle reached 108 degrees Fahrenheit Monday. Portland hit 116 degrees, while the village of Lytton, British Columbia, hit 46.1 degrees Celsius, or 115 degrees Fahrenheit, the highest surface temperature ever recorded in Canada. More than 12,000 residents of Western Washington lost power amid surging demand for electricity. A wildfire spread below high-voltage power lines in King County.
I mean, it's already bad enough not having air conditioning, but to have no power at all in this heat is dangerous.
In Russia, torrential rains and heavy winds tore through Moscow Monday, flooding streets and subway lines, uprooting trees. The violent storm broke a record-setting heat wave that saw Moscow and St. Petersburg reach their highest June temperatures on record. Last week, a Siberian town above the Arctic Circle, known for its extreme cold temperatures, recorded a peak ground temperature of 118 degrees Fahrenheit. In Washington, D.C., hundreds of youth climate activists surrounded the White House Monday in a nonviolent blockade demanding President Biden take meaningful action on the climate emergency. Secret Service agents made dozens of arrests. Members of the Sunrise Movement are calling on Biden and congressional Democrats to pass an infrastructure bill that includes major investments in green energy, including a fully funded civilian climate corps. Joining the protest was New York Democratic Congressman Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, who said there was no time to waste in preventing the climate catastrophe.
What a lot of folks here in D.C. don't understand is that while this may be the hottest summer of their lives, it's going to be one of the coolest summers of our lives. Yeah. And so what that means is that they brought this heat on us, so we bring the heat on them.
We'll have more on the fight over infrastructure spending later in the broadcast. We'll be speaking with New York Congressmember Jamal Bowman, who joined the Sunrise Movement protest yesterday. In the northern Minnesota, Hubbard County Sheriff's deputies Monday barricaded access to an encampment of water protectors who are resisting construction of the Enbridge Line 3 tar sands pipeline, which has the backing of the Biden administration. Officers towed several of the activists' cars and made several arrests throughout the day. An attorney for the indigenous-led protesters called the move, quote, nothing less than an overt political blockade. In Ethiopia, rebel fighters in the war-torn Tigray region are dismissing the Ethiopian government's unilateral declaration of a ceasefire after its military retreated from Tigray's capital on Monday. The Tigray People's Liberation Front has claimed control of the city's airport and other strategic areas and says its forces will continue to drive out Ethiopian troops from the region. Nearly a million civilians have been internally displaced since Ethiopia launched an offensive against Tigray separatists in November. The United Nations says the fighting has pushed 350,000 people to the brink of famine. A U.S. military base near a major oil field in eastern Syria came under attack Monday, one day after the Biden administration launched airstrikes in Syria and Iraq, targeting an Iranian-backed militia. The U.S. responded by firing artillery at nearby rocket-launching positions. On Monday, President Biden defended his decision to order airstrikes.
I directed last night's airstrikes targeting sites used by the Iranian-backed militia groups responsible for recent attacks on the U.S. personnel in Iraq. And I have that authority under Article 2, and even the those up in the Hill who are reluctant to acknowledge that have acknowledged that's the case.
This comes as criticism of the U.S. airstrikes grow. Iraq's prime minister condemned the U.S. attack as a, quote, blatant and unacceptable violation of Iraqi sovereignty and Iraqi national security. We'll have more on this story later in the broadcast. A federal judge has thrown out two antitrust lawsuits seeking to force Facebook to divest from WhatsApp and Instagram. U.S. District Court Judge Jeb Boasberg, a George W. Bush appointee, ruled the Federal Trade Commission failed to provide enough evidence to make a case that Facebook operated a monopoly. The judge gave the FTC 30 days to file an amended lawsuit. In a second ruling, Judge Boasberg threw out another antitrust suit brought by 46 state attorneys general, ruling they waited too long to bring their claims. The court ruling sent Facebook's share price soaring, bringing CEO Mark Zuckerberg's estimated personal wealth to over $128 billion, while Facebook's market capitalization topped $1 trillion for the first time. A new book claims former President Donald Trump asked in February of 2020 if the U.S. could send citizens infected with coronavirus to the Guantanamo Bay prison, asking aides in the White House Situation Room, don't we have an island that we own? Washington Post reporters Yasmin Abutaleb and Damian Paletta also write in their book, Nightmare Scenario, that Trump complained to then-Health and Human Services Secretary Alex Azar on March 18th about coronavirus testing. Trump reportedly said, I'm going to lose the election because of testing. What idiot had the federal government do testing? In Florida, hope is fading that search and rescue crews will find more survivors of the Surfside condominium disaster 5 days after the building suddenly collapsed into a massive pile of twisted steel and rubble. The confirmed death toll has risen to 11, with 150 people still unaccounted for. CNN reports the Champlain Tower South Condo Association was facing assessments for $15 million worth of repairs, with payments set to begin just 1 week after the building's sudden collapse. The e-cigarette maker Juul Labs has agreed to pay $40 million to settle a lawsuit brought by North Carolina, charging its marketing practices led to widespread nicotine addiction among teenagers. The settlement comes as 13 other states and the District of Columbia are pressing similar lawsuits and as the Food and Drug Administration is considering whether to allow Juul products to remain on the market. In a landmark victory for transgender rights, the U.S. Supreme Court announced Monday it will not hear the case of Gavin Grimm, a former high school student who sued his local school district over its policy forcing him to use a separate single-stall restroom that no other student was required to use. The court's move lets stand a lower court ruling that policies segregating trans students from their peers are unconstitutional. Gavin Grimm spoke to Democracy Now! In 2017.
when you are in an environment where you're not being affirmed and when you're being separated and kept apart from your peers, not only does that send a very negative message to you, but it sends a very negative message to your peers and kind of conveys a precedent for how they'll treat you. So I think it's very important that we talk about rights of bathroom usage for trans youth, especially because if you can't use a bathroom, you can't participate in public life. And that's really what's at the center of this.
California will restrict state-funded travel to Arkansas, Florida, Montana, North Dakota, and West Virginia, bringing to 17 the number of states sanctioned by California over their discriminatory policies toward LGBTQ plus people. California Attorney General Rob Bonta cited recently passed laws banning transgender youth from playing sports and blocking access to life-saving gender-affirming health care.
There is a coordinated attack against our fundamental civil rights. And the fact is, when states discriminate against LGBTQ Americans, California law requires our office to take action, and that's what we're doing today.
In Honduras, LGBTQ plus rights advocates are celebrating a historic ruling by the Inter-American Court of Human Rights, declaring the Honduran state responsible for the 2009 killing of Vicky Hernandez, a transgender woman. Hernandez was assassinated June 28th, the day a U.S.-backed coup overthrew former democratically elected President Manuel Zelaya, installing a right-wing regime. Hernandez was a sex worker and was out during a military curfew. The landmark ruling was issued Monday on the 12th anniversary of the U.S.-backed coup in Honduras and mandates reparations for Hernandez's family and for Honduras to reopen her case. Mexico's Supreme Court has decriminalized the use of marijuana for adults. The court's ruling comes after the Mexican Congress failed to enact legislation legalizing recreational use of marijuana by the end of April, a deadline set by the Supreme Court. While many celebrated the ruling, some critics warned there are still legal loopholes that could criminalize people for cultivating or distributing marijuana. Efforts to legalize marijuana in Mexico are also aimed at curbing drug violence in the country. Since the U.S.-backed so-called war on drugs was launched in 2006, over 300,000 people have been killed. A new UN report is calling on all nations to dismantle racism and end impunity for police officers who kill and violate the human rights of black people. The long-awaited report was released by the UN High Commissioner for Human Rights Monday, just days after former Minneapolis police officer and convicted murderer Derek Chauvin was sentenced to 22 years in prison for killing George Floyd. The report looked into over 190 police killings, most of which occurred in the United States, followed by Latin America. This is Mona Rashmawi with the UN's Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights.
We found worrying trends of associating blackness with criminality and other biases that shape the interaction of people of African descent with law enforcement and the criminal justice system. Our research shows that in a number of states, people of African descent are particularly vulnerable to racial profiling, notably as a basis for discriminatory identity checks, stops and searches, arrests, and related abuses. Also to violence, including serious injury and deaths.
And U.S. Olympic hammer thrower Gwen Berry is facing backlash after turning her back to the U.S. flag while the national anthem played during a medal ceremony at the U.S. Olympic trials in Eugene, Oregon, Saturday. Toward the end of the anthem, Berry turned away from the flag and placed a black T-shirt with the words "activist athlete" on her head. Following the nonviolent protest, Berry said, quote, "My purpose and my mission is bigger than sports. I'm here to represent those who died due to systemic racism. That's the important part. That's why I'm going. That's why I'm here today," she said. Berry is a longtime activist who famously raised her fist during the Star Spangled Banner after winning gold at the 2019 Pan American Games. And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman in New York City, joined by Democracy Now! Co-host Juan Gonzalez in New Brunswick, New Jersey. Hi, Juan.
Hi, Amy, and welcome to all of our listeners and viewers across the country and around the world.
Well, in Washington, D.C., hundreds of youth climate activists surrounded the White House Monday in a nonviolent blockade demanding President Biden take meaningful action on the climate crisis. Secret Service agents made dozens of arrests. Members of the Sunrise Movement called on Biden and congressional Democrats to pass an infrastructure bill that includes major investments in green energy, including a fully funded civilian climate corps. The protest came as the states of Oregon and Washington, as well as the Canadian province of British Columbia, battled historic heat. Portland hit 116 degrees Fahrenheit on Monday, making it one of the hottest places in the world. The Sunrise Movement timed its protest as negotiations heat up over infrastructure spending. Last week, President Biden announced he'd reached a bipartisan deal with senators on a slimmed-down infrastructure spending bill. Meanwhile, Democrats are hoping to pass a second larger infrastructure package, the American Families Plan, using the budget reconciliation process, which would not require any Republican votes. Biden initially said he would not sign the bipartisan infrastructure deal without the other, then walked back his statement after facing criticism from Republican lawmakers. We're joined now by David Dayan, the executive editor of the American Prospect, as well as New York Democratic Congressmember Jamal Bowman, who took part in the Sunrise Movement protest on Monday. Congressmember Bowman, thanks so much for rejoining us. Talk about yesterday's protest. I mean, the historic heat wave that's hitting the Northwest. What is happening to the Green New Deal being stripped out of this deal that Biden apparently made with other Democratic and Republican senators, but then, because of backlash, said he would veto the smaller deal unless the larger Green New Deal included bill were also passed?
Well, thank you for having me. Yesterday's protests were very powerful. Very inspiring and very necessary. The sea of young people chanting and demanding justice on climate was just so moving, and I was really honored to be a part of it. And the Republican negotiated bipartisan infrastructure deal is completely unacceptable on its own and on its face. It does not meet the moment in terms of responding to climate change, and it does not meet the moment in terms of our overall infrastructure needs. You know, the president ran on a platform on climate justice, on racial justice. He had progressives across the country organizing in support of him to not only help him get the White House, but also to help Democrats win the Senate. And this is where we are. And you know, we've been trying to negotiate with Republicans, not only in terms of this bill, but on smaller bills in the House and in the Senate. You know, and they continue to vote down transformative policy like S1 and continue to show that they're not willing to negotiate in good faith. So we have a process. We have a reconciliation process that gives us the opportunity to invest transformatively in communities that have been historically marginalized while also dealing with the issue of climate change. So this is where we are, and this is why we have to move forward. But it's not just the president. Senator Manchin needs to make sure he is on board. Senator Sinema needs to make sure she is on board so that we can have enough Democratic votes to move a robust transformative infrastructure reconciliation package.
But, Congressman, what do you say to those who will tell you the votes aren't there, that because of people like Joe Manchin and Sinema, that even among the Democrats, there aren't sufficient votes to get the kind of infrastructure plan, both in terms of physical infrastructure and human infrastructure, that you and other progressive Democrats want?
Well, that answer is unacceptable. If Senator Manchin and Senator Sinema really care about our country and really care about democracy, they would know and understand that this is the moment to invest in areas that have been historically ignored, like the care economy, like public housing, like green infrastructure. And this is why we have to speak honestly and truthfully about who Senator Manchin and Senator Sinema are more beholden and responsive to. Are they more responsive to the corporate elite, large corporations, their wealthy donors, or are they more responsive to the American people? What Democrats are fighting for and what we've been sent here to do is do the job of the American people. So to say we don't have the votes is unacceptable. I represent the Bronx, Mount Vernon, Yonkers, and New Rochelle that have pockets of poverty as high as 30% in some areas. Those areas are disproportionately black and brown. Those areas disproportionately suffer from asthma because of environmental conditions. They live in public housing that's been neglected. We have our children living with lead paint. These issues are happening in West Virginia as well, the state that Joe Manchin represents. So let's speak honestly about what's happening here. They're not upholding democracy. They are upholding corporate control of government and their wealthy backers. And we are fighting for the American people. That's why the American people are with us. And if we want to maintain control and the opportunity to do great work in 2022, it's time for Democrats to deliver in this moment.
Now, you tweeted in a video where you toured the public housing units where you grew up and showed some of the problems there. Could you talk about some of the specific infrastructure issues that you see in your own district?
So first of all, if there's molding in a public housing apartment or something is broken and needs to be fixed, when you call maintenance to have them come fix the problem, the lag time is unbelievably long. And that's because there aren't enough employees, there aren't enough properly trained employees, because we don't have the money to hire those employees. When we see in other areas of public housing in my district, doors are broken wide open where there's no safety and security. You could walk right into the building. In other cases, you have mailboxes broken wide open. The trash reciprocal it's outdated. It was built decades ago, so you can't fit the trash bag into the reciprocal properly. So people are taking their trash outside and dumping it in a designated area outside. But because there isn't, we don't even have the large trash bins to dump the trash into the bin. So it's right there on the street, and we don't have enough people to clean up the trash, so it remains outside, which leads to rodent infestation, which leads to roaches, et cetera, all impacting the breathing and how our children live within these spaces. And I also want to mention, this is very important, these are redlined communities. And I always connect what we're talking about now to the New Deal. The New Deal that built the white suburbs, the New Deal that built white suburban wealth and purposely, explicitly kept African Americans out of those communities. Like, they could not access the federally subsidized home loans to move to the suburbs. So they were forced to live in ghettos and had those ghettos undervalued just because the people were black. Like, this is what we're responding to, this historical racism and historical harm. And we can go even further back to the Homestead Act and what happened there. So this is our moment. And I believe President Biden knows that. But we have to continue to engage and put pressure on the White House and my colleagues in Congress to go big and invest in the way we need to invest. Because if they care about this country, if we give everyone an opportunity, America will finally reach the ideals of its democracy.
So, in addition to Congressmember Jamal Bowman, we're joined by David Dayan, executive editor of The American Prospect, his latest book, Monopolize, Life in the Age of Corporate Power. David, you've been following these debates very closely. You have Mitch McConnell saying, President Biden, you better rein in Schumer and Pelosi. For people who aren't following the ins and outs of what turned into the major conflagration of the week, not the climate emergency, but Biden saying he would veto the infrastructure bill, the bipartisan one, if it didn't include linking to the reconciliation bill that Senator Sanders would be in charge of. And by the way, Senator Sanders tweeted out, no reconciliation bill, no deal. Tell us the ins and outs of this and what you think that smaller Republican infrastructure bill is really a cover for.
Sure. I mean, Biden's statement was really a recitation of Speaker Pelosi's statement made hours earlier, where she said that the House wouldn't vote on the bipartisan bill until the Senate passed a reconciliation bill. And that reflected work that was done by Representative Bowman and other members of the Progressive Caucus, who informed Pelosi that they wouldn't move forward on a bill until there were two bills passed in the Senate. And that's really what's driving this. And it's a bit unusual to see progressives really drive kind of the agenda in Congress. But Pelosi knows that she can't afford to lose those votes on her left. And it's a bigger threat to the overall project of a big infrastructure package than moderates would be to passing in the House. So that really was the dynamic, and Biden really mimicked it. But Republicans who knew this was all happening and who indeed proposed a two-stage process initially, calculating that a second reconciliation bill would get bogged down in infighting among Democrats. But because Pelosi kind of figured out a way to pass the two-stage process in a way that gave everyone trust that two bills would actually go forward, I think that they were mad that it was said out loud. It was something that was obviously going to happen, but they didn't want to see it linked like that. And so Biden walked it back, but he didn't really walk it back. He just said that, you know, Republicans can try to stop the second bill, but of course they don't have the votes for that necessarily. And Pelosi and Schumer are going to run the process. What you lay out there is correct. I think progressives have done a decent job of linking these two bills. But what's the key piece of the bipartisan bill to me, in addition to the lack of climate measures, and as you correctly point out, the fact that the nature from Seattle to Miami, where sea level rise may have been a large contributor to the collapse of the condo building, is just screaming for a change in priorities in America because of the climate crisis and a need to upgrade our infrastructure to reflect this new reality. But the other thing that's in that bipartisan bill is privatization. So it's really the selling off of infrastructure to private companies, and really the substitution of public tax collection, where we pay for these common assets that we all use and share, to private tax collection, where you sell the infrastructure asset to a private company, whether for toll roads or privatized water systems, privatized parking meters or what have you, and that private company gets to effectively tax the public. And inevitably, that tax goes up because they have to build in their layer of profit. So I think that's something that progressives like Representative Bowman need to focus on. Because it's a very dangerous part of the bipartisan bill.
But David Dayne, are those concerns sufficient for many progressives to say no? Let's kill this thing altogether, because clearly the move to privatize public assets has been part of the neoliberal agenda now for about four decades.
It has been, and that's why it's incumbent to take a stand at this point. I mean, you have a representative on; you can ask him if that's sufficient or not. But it is a serious issue. I mean, we have examples of this, as you say, Juan, all over the country. Water systems that charge exorbitant rates, parking meters in places like Chicago that have gone up 800% in their rates over a number of years, and every time the street is shut down for a street fair, the private company gets to recoup lost revenue from that day. It's not just the gouging of the people who use the infrastructure. It's the loss of democratic control. So a private company is in charge and says when the street will be shut down or not. And the private company is in charge of when a certain toll road is open or not. So that's, I think, at the core of the issue with privatization, which, as you correctly point out, was part of this neoliberal project. But we're in a new era, and I would hope that there would be very strong pushback against it.
And what about that, Congressman Bowman, in terms of in Chicago, for instance, a private parking meter company, whenever the city wants to shut down a street for a parade, it has to reimburse the private parking meter company for its lost revenues. What about this issue of even in the compromise bill, there being some poison pills in there?
Another reason why it's unacceptable, and poison pill, I think, is a great way to describe it. I mean, we don't have to go to Chicago. Right here in my district, the privatization of public housing has taken hold. The Yonkers, you know, I represent Yonkers as well. Public housing in Yonkers has been given over to privatizers before I got into office. Edenwall Houses and Baychester Houses has already been given over to privatizers, a company called RAD in New York. And Edenwall Houses is going through that process right now. And as you know, Juan, you know my work in public schools and what's happened with charter schools and vouchers and the siphoning of public resources. And that's the thing, right? We're fighting for the reconciliation package to go big, but we're also fighting to keep it public. When you look at the public housing investment in the infrastructure package, for example, of $50 billion, it sounds like a big number, but the capital needs in NYCHA alone are about $40 billion. So $50 billion will not meet the national needs. So we're fighting to keep it big, and we're fighting to keep it public. But it's true, we have to even sound a louder alarm and be more outspoken against this privatization piece, because that's what that negotiated bipartisan bill does. But it's another example of corporate control of our government and who Republicans are fighting for. They are fighting for the privatizers, not the rest of us. And this is why what happened at the White House yesterday needs to be replicated here in D.C. and across the country by everyone, because they'll privatize the entire country if we allow them to.
Well, we want to thank you both for being with us. And, of course, we're going to continue to follow this issue as, well, at least for this moment, it's parts of the Northwest have become some of the hottest places on Earth. Congressmember Jamal Bowman of New York was out there yesterday at the Sunrise Movement protest outside the White House, where many got arrested. And David Dayan, executive editor of the American Prospect, we will link to your latest piece, his latest book, Monopolized Life in the Age of Corporate Power. Next up, a U.S. military base near a Syrian oil field comes under attack one day after U.S. airstrikes targeted an Iranian-backed militia in Syria and Iraq. We'll get the latest. Stay with us.
Free, like a bird out in the wind of the night. Like a 747 to LA up in flight. Free, like a garden flourishing in the wind. Like a student about to do it when he's graduating. Free, from any other energy perception. Can never be defined, create the definition within. Free, just loving life itself and never pretend to be anything other than the man I was meant to be. Travel through time and get a glimpse of the centuries. To come a better day is promised, remember free. Like my nephew in a few months about to be out the penitentiary. Meditation, 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 meditation. Meditation. I never hesitate about a reluctant mind. Just put the
pedal to the metal, see what you find. Your back is slouching over, won't you big up your spine? Let's make it really, really happen, live up this time. Cause you could choose to say good morning, God, a good God morning, with black clouds storming. I walk without umbrellas in any woods, don't need it cause the mighty trees above will shelter me good. I'm eating berries from the bushes of the heavenly goods. Upon the states, the power came through us whenever we stood, reverberating out of reach in each and every hood, whenever we could. The spiritual anatomy, fool, but never take the credit for it, because that'd be rude. It's just the way of life we searching for that had to be new. You gotta work it though, cause every day ain't Saturday, fool. We've all been
First in Flight by Blackalicious, the always amazing MC Gift of Gab, died June 18th. Of kidney failure. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez. A U.S. military base near a major oil field in eastern Syria came under attack Monday, one day after the Biden administration launched airstrikes in Syria and Iraq targeting an Iranian-backed militia. Shortly before 8 p.m. local time, multiple rockets hit the U.S. base near the U.S.-controlled Al-Omar oil field. The U.S. responded, directing artillery fire at nearby rocket launching positions. This comes as criticism of the U.S. airstrikes grow. Iraq's prime minister condemned the U.S. attack as a, quote, blatant and unacceptable violation of Iraqi sovereignty and Iraqi national security, unquote. A symbolic funeral was held today in Baghdad for four members of the Iraq Popular Mobilization Forces killed in the U.S. strikes. Syrian media is recording Iran's foreign ministry accused the United States of, quote, disrupting security in the region. On Monday, U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken defended the U.S. military strikes, claiming they were done in self-defense.
We took necessary, appropriate, deliberate action that is designed to limit the risk of escalation, but also to send a clear and unambiguous deterrent message. This action in self-defense to do what's necessary to prevent further attacks, I think, sends a very important and strong message. And I hope very much that it is received by those who are intended to receive it.
The U.S. military airstrikes come at a time when the Biden administration's holding indirect talks with Iran about reviving the Iranian nuclear deal. We're joined right now by Jamal Abdi, the president of the National Iranian American Council. Welcome to Democracy Now! Can you respond to these attacks?
Well, you know, it's hard to find something novel to say about the United States bombing Iraq at this point in time. We've been doing this for 30 years. But this comes at a time when, you know, the Biden administration has potentially the opportunity to pivot off of this track that was laid for them by the Trump administration, where they are engaged in this constant tit for tat and attempting to roll back Iranian influence and striking Iranian forces. And as we see, by failing to pivot away from that and instead bombing targets inside of Iraq, we are giving more fuel to this conflict. And instead of disincentivizing further attacks by, you know, Iran-linked groups, we see immediately retaliation. And this is how these things continue to bog the United States down in the region. And unless Biden is able to break out of this cycle, this is the norm that we're going to be continuing.
And Jamal, what is the Iraq Popular Mobilization Forces, and what is their connection, if any, to Iran? And also, what's the status of U.S. troops in Iraq these days? How many are there?
Yeah, so the groups that Biden struck are part of the Popular Mobilization Units, which were formed to combat ISIS and have been integrated in the Iraqi security forces. And so this is very much, from the Iraqi perspective, a violation of their sovereignty. This is an attack on, groups that are part of the security forces. The United States is still in Iraq. The Iraqis, actually, the parliament voted to kick the United States out back when Donald Trump was doing these strikes. And when Donald Trump actually killed the Iranian general, Soleimani, and the leader of one of the groups that Biden then struck yesterday. After those strikes in 2020, the Iraqis voted to kick the United States out. The U.S. is still there. I think there are about 3,000 troops in a advise and assist role to support the Iraqi government. But as we see, you know, this is not having a stabilizing effect. And actually, the United States is a target for these groups that prior to the Donald Trump administration were actually working, if not in coordination with the United States, then in close proximity with the United States. And we weren't having these conflicts. And I don't think it's any coincidence that that was when the United States and Iran had a deal. We were at the diplomatic table. We had a nuclear agreement. And we actually started to see this trend reverse. Now we're back in a state where we don't have a nuclear agreement. We're trying to get back to there. The U.S. is in Iraq, but in a, you know, in a different role. And Biden supposedly wants to, you know, withdraw from the region or draw down from the region. And the failure of diplomacy combined with the willingness to engage in these strikes to supposedly create a deterrent, but actually to put a big target on our backs, is a very bad place to be, and it's hard to see a way out of it unless there is a diplomatic breakthrough.
Jamal, this is like a rite of passage, and Biden already did this once, so this is the second time since he's come to office. But he is the sixth U.S. president in a row to bomb Iraq. I mean, you have George H.W. Bush, you have President Clinton, President George W. Bush, you have President Obama, you have President Trump, and then you have Biden. Now, let me play how the White House spokesperson Jen Psaki defended the airstrikes.
The targeted strikes were directed at facilities used by Iran-backed militias involved in these ongoing attacks for purposes including weapon storage, command logistics, and unmanned aerial vehicle operations. So Article 2, the self-defense, the defense of the United States and our interests, is our domestic justification for these strikes announced yesterday. The president's view is that it was necessary, appropriate, and deliberate action, these strikes, designed to limit the risk of escalation.
So they're saying, the U.S. is saying it was self-defense. But it's also interesting that the airstrikes come 2 weeks after the House of Representatives voted to repeal the AUMF, the 2002 Authorization for Use of Military Force, which grants sweeping war powers to the president. What will this mean for the nuclear deal that the supposedly is President Biden is attempting to revive?
As you know, the talks to revive the nuclear deal are ongoing. We're now in this awkward position where we have a lame duck administration in Iran, who the Rouhani government, who placed all of its political hopes and capital in the prospect of detente with the West and with the United States and getting this nuclear deal, to then have the rug pulled out from under it by Donald Trump. And now we are where we are today, where Iran is expanding its nuclear program. And Iranians are suffering under sanctions, COVID, government mismanagement. And it's a terrible situation. The talks are ongoing, and I think that the talks may still yield a return to the deal. I don't think that's necessarily off the table, but I think these actions make it a lot more difficult and have a risk of poisoning the atmosphere there. That being said, you know, I do think that the Iranian Supreme Leader has signaled that he does want to get this deal, and the incoming president, the hardline Ebrahim Raisi, has also, if not signaled his support for the deal, signaled that he will accept it. And I think what really is going to determine whether that happens, it may be these negotiations with this outgoing sort of quote-unquote friendly administration in Iran. But it also may come under this new government. And the question then is, what does that then build towards? Is there further diplomacy that can happen? It does not look like that's going to be the case. I think for Congress, you know, you hear a lot of voices from Congress criticizing these talks and saying, you know, either we need to not be talking to Iran or we need to seek this bigger and better deal that Donald Trump was trying to get. So there's no bigger or better deal on the table unless we return to these obligations. And I just think the fact that the Biden administration is using this legally dubious grounds for these strikes and keeping Congress out of that conversation. Congress is supposed to be authorizing the wars. They're not involved. So they're totally detached from the consequences of the failure of diplomacy. And so it's very easy to cheerlead these strikes and to criticize diplomacy for members of Congress who don't actually have any skin in the game when it comes to having to authorize these strikes that are very unpopular among the American public.
I wanted to ask you also this whole issue of self-defense. Given that the isn't this the essence of what how an imperial power operates? If you station enough troops around the world, and of course the United States has troops in scores of countries around the world, you could always claim self-defense of the United States because you're so extended in so many different parts that have really no direct relation to our own country.
Yeah, absolutely. And the U.S. presence in Iraq, I mean, going back to 1991, the U.S. presence in Iraq and the region have only put targets on the United States' back and given rationalization to groups that want to see, you know, legitimately or illegitimately, you know, I let you decide, but want to see the United States out of the region. And that's exactly what we're doing. You know, counter to popular belief, Iran is not going to leave the region. They're stuck there, geographically stuck there. The United States isn't. And the notion that we're going to perpetually be, whether it's having a, you know, large-scale troop presence there, or even this more limited presence, but continuing to engage in these deterrent strikes and this tit for tat is going to lead to any new results just belies the past, you know, 30 years of history with the United States in the region.
Jamal Abdi, we want to thank you for being with us. And of course, we're going to continue to cover this. President of the National Iranian American Council. This is Democracy Now! Next up, Vice President Harris did go to the border Friday, went to El Paso, Texas, but didn't go to this massive emergency shelter for migrant children at Fort Bliss Military Base. The Border Network for Human Rights held a protest there with other groups yesterday demanding that the site for the children be shut down. Stay with us.
Cuando lo estaba queriendo, cuando lo estaba sintiendo, todito mío lo vi partir. Me juro que regresaba, pero todo era mentira, porque ya su alma no era de mí. En la noche silenciosa nos miraba.
Stone Crucifix by Mariachi Arcoiris de Los Angeles. This is Democracy Now! I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez. Suicide attempts, spoiled food, extreme heat. These are among the conditions described by boys and girls held at the country's largest emergency so-called shelter for migrant children on the Fort Bliss military base in El Paso, Texas. The unlicensed facility has been described as a tent city that can hold 10,000 unaccompanied children in soft-sided tents on desert land. It currently holds about 800 kids, all boys. Vice President Harris did not visit the site when she traveled to El Paso Friday on a visit to the border. That task was left to the Secretary of the Department of Health and Human Services, Javier Becerra, who was met with protests when he toured Fort Bliss on Monday. Shut it down, the little girl is saying. Shut it down. More than 14,000 migrant children are now in the custody of the Department of Health and Human Services, which set up 15 emergency sites like Fort Bliss to get them out of overcrowded Border Patrol holding facilities. But some kids have been held there for months. Court records cited by CBS News quote a 17-year-old Guatemalan girl held at Fort Bliss for 60 days, who said she got so anxious she once fainted, and that after she reported not sleeping for 3 days, she was prescribed medication. During an event last Thursday, Becerra defended conditions at Fort Bliss.
I will agree with anyone who says that that's not where you're going to do long-term care for a child. We get that. But it's far better than the deserts they were in. It is far better than an adult detention facility, and it is absolutely providing them, these children, with everything you would expect a child to get to provide for their basic needs and the attention that they require.
For more, we go to El Paso, Texas, to speak with Fernando Garcia, founding director of the Border Network for Human Rights, which has been part of protests to shut down the emergency so-called shelter at Fort Bliss. Among the advocates who actually spoke to Vice President Kamala Harris on Friday. Fernando, thanks so much for joining us again. Why don't you start off by talking about your demands to close this site for children at Fort Bliss, and then what you said to the Vice President Friday.
Yes, Amy, Juan, thanks for having me again. Listen, we had done this several times already. This is not the first protest. We did it, we've been doing it like very often because we, since the very beginning, we had seen thousands of unaccompanied minors arriving to this location. Listen, there are two main problems with this location. The first one is that this is a military base. This is Fort Bliss. And as you might imagine, there is no accountability and transparency. I mean, nobody can go into Fort Bliss without going through a number of filters. So access to that location is very difficult for media, but also for human rights organizations. So I think that is fundamentally a problem. The second thing is what that represents. I mean, what is the message that having children in a military base represents? I mean, that means that they're a danger for our society. It is incomprehensible in that sense. But going back to the question of why we're protesting is we had seen so many incidents of potential abuse inside that specific detention center. They call them shelters, but for us, it's a detention center. And it was mentioned in the introduction. I mean, we had people reporting to us directly about the lack of food, healthcare, the lack of basic services, but also to a point that teenagers, children had decided to commit suicide because of the conditions inside. So I think for us, it's beyond repair. I think no improvement would be enough. I think for us, it is important that this administration close this detention center. So that is what the protest was about. And when the vice president came, to be honest, I mean, we thought that it was going to be a political show. As you know, always it's a political show. Whatever the people in this or in the former administration do is exactly that. So we were concerned about it. But we had a chance to meet with Vice President Harris. And surprisingly, she was listening. And she listened to what we proposed. It was a very short meeting, less than an hour, but I think she was engaged, and I think I really appreciate that opportunity.
And Fernando, in terms of the Biden administration saying that they at least have been working to reduce the number of children from a few months ago, do you see, generally speaking, that they're moving in a better direction?
No, I don't think so. I mean, we have systemic problems with the detention centers for children in this country, especially at the border. One of them is that these detention centers are run by contractors, private contractors. When I say that is that it is true that HHS is the entity that coordinates those detention centers or shelters. But they are run, and the people that actually is taking care of those children are people connected to private contractors. So we don't believe that is the option. Either whether they are 4,000 children or 800 children, I think that doesn't change the dynamic, that there's a fundamental lack of transparency. And secondly, that those children shouldn't be detained at all. I think we were protesting yesterday, and probably you heard that we are asking for these detention centers to be closed, but also to reunify those children with the family members. 80% of those children, unaccompanied minors, they have a relative in the United States that can receive them. So I think they should improve that process. They should invest mostly on reunifying these children with their families rather than building these shelters and these facilities.
And I wanted to ask you about the continued role of the U.S. in denying whether, no matter what administration, the U.S. impact on migration. It's the U.S. foreign policy in Central America. Vice President Harris, when she went to Central America recently, did not acknowledge the U.S. role in creating these crises. Your response to that?
Well, you know, if we really want to tackle down root causes, we need to recognize that the United States is responsible for many of those root causes that actually expel people from their countries. Let's take, for example, a couple of things. Violence and mayhem and armed criminal bands in Central America and in Mexico. Well, the weapons that they are getting them from the United States. And nothing has been done in that regard. So, I mean, if we want to stop the violence, we need to start here in the United States. I mean, we need to stop the flow of weapons. And secondly, we're talking about people fleeing economic conditions, poverty, lack of basic services. Well, the economic agreements that the United States has in the past proposed and actually carry out are the result. I mean, they are the part of the problem in that sense, that they are not creating the conditions where workers will have a living standard, better wages, housing, healthcare. So people is going into Central America. Companies are going into Central America with these trade agreements, but they are not paying more. They are not raising the economic levels and the economic standards. So we need to start with reforming those economic agreements to actually be sure that we have enough to invest in those countries where people do not have to leave their countries.
So, Fernando, apparently Vice President Harris went to El Paso because that's where Trump's separation policy began, and the Biden administration wanted to show the difference between them. There were a few photo ops a few weeks ago showing families reunited. But in fact, aren't there still thousands of children who are not reunited? What is happening in this case? Isn't even Dr. Biden, Jill Biden, involved with overseeing the speeding up of this process? As you describe, 80% of these kids have family members in the United States. How are they changing the Trump policy?
Listen, this is what I see with this administration. At the political, national level, from the White House, we do see a different narrative. I think there's a different message in regards to the last administration. I think Biden and Vice President Harris, it seems that they are saying that they are committed to have a dignified border, to rehumanize immigration. All of that is good, but that is not being yet translated to the ground. I mean, here at the border, we're still having at least two major problems that we had mentioned already that have not changed. One of them is Title 42. Title 42 is what I consider an illegal program that is expelling refugees, families, and children without due process. And many of them are fleeing this violence, are coming to the United States to ask for protection, and they are being expelled. Thousands of people being expelled. That program was implemented by Trump. It should have been gone the first day of this administration. It has not. So the second thing is precisely that we have thousands of children in detention. So instead of investing in jails, instead of investing in detention centers, in these big shelters in Fort Bliss, for example, this administration should have done exactly that, built welcoming centers to expedite the family reunification and to do it in a different way. But we have not seen that specifically. So I think one is the national rhetoric, and the second thing is what is happening at the border is not necessarily reflecting that rhetoric.
Well, we want to thank you so much for being with us. Fernando Garcia, founding director of the Border Network for Human Rights in El Paso. He met with Vice President Harris when she went to the border on Friday. That does it for our show. A happy belated birthday to John Randolph. Democracy Now! Is produced with Renee Feltz, Mike Burke, Dina Guzder, Messiah Rhodes, Nermeen Sheikh, Maria Teresa Sena, Carla Wills, Tammy Warrenoff, Tarina Nadura, Sam Alkoff, Tamari Astudio, John Hamilton, Rabbi Karen, Honey Masood, President Adriana Contreras. Our general manager is Julie Crosby. Special thanks to Becca Staley, Miriam Barnard, Paul Powell, Mike DeFilippo, Miguel Noguera, Hugh Grant, Dennis Moynihan. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez. Stay safe.